She is survived by her children, Carl Johnson, Patsy King, and her husband Thomas, Phyllis Westenhofer, and her husband Jim, and Lisa Rowland. Three siblings, Faye Million, Janice McBride, and Bruce Carter. 10 grandchildren, and 20 great-grandchildren. Would you please pray with me? Father, we thank you for the eternal promises you've given us, and our brother and sister sang about just a moment ago. We thank you for how your promises frame this entire day and this experience. So we grieve today, but we grieve with hope. We thank you that this earthly life is not all there is. And for Christians, death really is not the end. So, Father, with these things in mind, we do hurt and we grieve, but we also praise you. We praise you for Daisy. Thank you so much, Lord, for how you communicated your love through this dear woman to so many people. We praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. The 23rd Psalm, a Psalm of David. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ears, the Son of God discloses, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. He speaks and the sounds of his voice is so sweet, the birds hush their singing, and the melody that he gave to me within my heart is ringing, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. And the joy we share as we tarry there, Daisy King, as you well know, was a caring and compassionate person. She was always cutting up. She enjoyed trying to make people smile, make them laugh. And she liked to call everybody Cat. When she was younger, she really liked working with her flowers. And thinking about this, I thought how appropriate it was that her name was Daisy. It was like a daisy. There was a beauty there that proclaimed the glory of God. Even in recent years, Daisy found a lot of joy watching the birds come to her bird feeder. She loved birds too. Daisy loved her family dearly. They loved her too. And she loved having her family all together with one another. But perhaps the most distinctive thing about Daisy, at least of what I know, was that she loved children, especially babies. I served as the pastor of Berea Baptist Church, and Daisy worked in our nursery for 21 years. She loved our children, and proof of her love was the fact that our children loved her back. They adored her. I've observed that children tend to be most fond of and most loving toward people who really love them. They pick up on it. They can sense it. They respond to it. And they love Miss Daisy, as we called her. They loved her because Daisy radiated love to them. At Berea Baptist, so many of our people remember Miss Daisy very, very fondly. And we are so thankful for the blessing that she was to so many of our children over the years. Like I said, she did this for 21 years. The kids that were toddlers when she started out there, later on for some of them, she wound up holding their babies in the nursery. Now, as I said earlier, family meant a lot to Daisy. She loved her family to get together. She loved welcoming them. And today, we take comfort that Daisy is the one who has now been welcomed home. Do you find it odd that when we speak of dying and going to heaven, we'll often refer to it as going home? Do you ever notice that that's a bit strange? Why do we do that? Because for one thing, heaven is a place we've never been, and yet we call it home. Why is that? Well, heaven is indeed a homecoming because, as Scripture says, we will be reunited with those who have gone before us and were also followers of Jesus. I look forward to seeing my grandparents again. Daisy has been reunited with her friends and family who've already passed on. Those who trust in Jesus as Lord and Savior are reunited in Jesus in the hereafter. Heaven is home for Daisy because of who is waiting for her there. After my grandparents on my dad's side had both passed away, someone outside our family bought their house. And then, of course, we were no longer allowed to just go in and see the place. And since I grew up next door to that set of grandparents, I had played in that house almost every day when I was a child. And a few years ago, I happened to mention to my dad, I said, you know, it should be nice to be able to go in the old place and look around again. I've got so many memories in that house. And I'd love to go in and look around. And my dad surprised me by saying, son, I don't have any desire to go back into that house. And this surprised me because this was the home in which he was raised. That's where he grew up. And he had a kind, loving family. He adored his parents. And yet he was saying, no, I don't have any desire to go back in there. And when I asked him why not, he said this. He said, Mama and Daddy aren't there anymore. They're the ones who made it home. My dad wisely recognized that home isn't a place. Home is defined by our relationships with those we love. That's what makes home home. My family, over Christmas, we went down to East Tennessee, which is where I'm from. Don't hold that against me. But we went back to East Tennessee because my mom and dad are there, my sister and her family, and we had a great time. And it came time for us to come back earlier this week, and I needed to come back and do stuff for the church. But my daughter was like, Daddy, please, can we stay a little longer? So I checked with my wife and with my parents if they were okay. They said, yeah, just let them stay. So I came up here this week by myself. And this probably sounds bad, but I was looking forward to having several days at home just alone. My wife and I, we've got a 10-year-old, an 8-year-old. There's never a dull moment. There's not much quiet, as you might imagine. So I got back, and the first day back, I got to admit, the house, yeah, this is kind of nice. It is kind of quiet. I like this. But in the days since then, or in the night since then, during the days I've been working at the church, but in the evenings, it was too quiet. And something struck me. I was thinking about this last night as I was working on this funeral service. Something struck me about this. Without my wife and my kids there, that house that I've lived in for 13 years doesn't feel like home. I sat there last night and I realized it just feels like a house. My wife and my kids, they're the ones who make it home. See, home isn't a place. Home is something we experience in relationship with those we love and those who love us. That's what makes home. Did you know that God has prepared a home for you? Did you know that? You know, some people go through this entire earthly life and they never find home. They live in different houses, but because there's a lack of loving relationship, it doesn't ever feel like home. Well, did you know that the God who made you and the God who loves you, He wants to welcome you and me home. Jesus talked about preparing a home for us. Listen to this. This comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 14. Jesus taught us this. He said, do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. He says, my Father's house has many rooms. Receive God's grace. Have you heard about this? The grace of God, amazing grace, God's grace. Well, what is grace? In the biblical sense, grace is when God gives us something good that we don't deserve and we can't earn. No matter how hard I work, I will never be able to earn a home in heaven. I can't be that good. And neither can you, because we'll never live up to God's standard. But here's the grace. Grace is when God gives us something good that we don't deserve, that we can't earn. In Jesus, Jesus, in dying for our sins and rising from the dead, He offers to share His own righteousness with us. Are you kidding me?
That's what he does. The Bible's very clear on this. The righteousness that God wants to give us. Righteousness is right standing in with God. You're in right relationship with God. The righteousness that he wants to give us is his own. He says, look, I'll take your sin. I will pay for that on the cross. And I will share with you my own righteousness. And what that means, guys, is that we are welcomed into deep, loving communion with Almighty God forever. We're welcomed home. Do you have a home in heaven? Have you received God's amazing grace through Jesus? Does Jesus live in your heart? Or let me put it another way. Do you personally know Jesus? Or do you just know about it? There's a difference. Here in the South, so many people know about Jesus, but they don't really know him. Do you really know him? Do you know him? Do you walk with him? God created each of us to love him and to know him and to walk with him. God wants everyone to spend eternity with him. But here's the problem. Not everyone wants God. And God's not going to force himself on anyone. That's not the way love works. He's not going to say, oh, you're going to spend eternity with me whether you want to or not. That's not love. So God chooses to allow us to choose how we're going to respond to him. And we can respond according to the freedom he's given us. How have you responded to the love of God? What are you doing with that? God takes our choice with complete seriousness. And guys, this earthly life is the time we are given in which to make that choice. This is it. This earthly life, this is the place where we've got all this freedom and we can either completely ignore God or reject him or rebel against him or walk with him. We've got all this freedom. We can do whatever. And here God is giving us an opportunity to basically make up our minds. Do we want him or not? A lot of people want heaven, but they don't want God. And that's not the way it works. That's like saying, I want to go swimming, but I don't want to get wet. Well, it's a package deal. Heaven is just a place. That's not the point. God is the point. Jesus is the point. Jesus is the one who makes heaven heaven. Jesus died on the cross for you. He paid for your sins and my sins too. He did this so that we could be forgiven by God and be welcomed home to him. And whether or not you go to that home depends on how you respond to his love. He won't force himself on you, and so not all of us will go to that home, but we've all been invited. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. He didn't just love part of the world. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, John 3:16 says, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. You're not left out. Thank God, neither am I. So guys, what are we going to do with it? This gospel, this good news, this salvation that's offered us in Jesus, what are we going to do? None of us know which day here will be our last. But you have a Savior. You have a God who made you. You have a God who loves you no matter what you've done. You have a God who wants you to come home to be with him eventually. Are you going to accept that invitation? How are you responding to God's amazing grace?
Amazing grace. Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes the service here at the chapel. We're going to get ready to go to Berea Cemetery. What we're going to do, we're going to dismiss now, folks, on the second row and all the way back. We're just going to open up the doors. You can go right on out to your cars. We'll get ready to go to the cemetery. You've also got time to go to the restroom, things like that. Family here in the front, we're going to give you guys some time at the casket.